my feeling, you're born in St. Martin, it must mean something. At least that you get the residence so that your ability to pay taxes, ability to contribute to the country is there. You can't ship them out and make them go swim back to their country. I mean, this isn't a sea race. And you know, again, I think right before the program, my father was born in St. Martin. Now he's an American citizen. I don't have an American passport. My grandmother is Kitishan. I don't have a Kitishan passport, but I was born in St. Martin, and thank God that my mother was born in St. Martin, that I have a Dutch passport. I don't have a St. Martin passport, but I have a Dutch passport. So you can't deport me, but I don't think it's right for you to just come out and put people in a pandemonium. Do what has to be done, but have discussions. Mm-hmm. Relative discussions with the people. The problem is that St. Martin is going to run out of dollars. So if we don't do something with opening the economy, we're going to have a problem. No social program, no stimulus package that is going on can save St. Martin from that. And even if the Dutch are super happy and they give us more than the little a bit of cash flow that they're giving us now, that is not going to save St. Martin. The only way of saving St. Martin is basically opening the economy. Now, do we have to be very careful of how we open the economy? Of course we do. Taking care, like I said, I too have a son that suffers from asthma. I too suffer from asthma. My mother, my mother-in-law, and I have other family members with ailments. I think we have to make sure that we take care of them, but at the same time, we need to open up the country to be able to get tourism back running. You're stuck between a rock and a hard place in the sense, do you, say, open your country, or do we keep it closed and we just wait for the eventual position where we're going to run out of dollars and we're going to die from starvation? I'm sorry to say that way and that hard, but St. Martin is facing an even greater problem, which is the economic crisis that is looming right now. People don't realize the fact that, and you don't have to be an economist, but understanding how all our goods come in is based on the U.S. dollar. So if tourists are not coming in and they're not bringing in U.S. dollars, we can't buy, we use the U.S. dollar to buy food and merchandise and products and clothes and everything from abroad with the U.S. dollar. Now, for the last 3 months or more, actually, there has been no U.S. dollars coming into the country because there is no tourism in the country. So we don't have a machine like in the U.S. where they press the button and then U.S. dollars are being printed. It is based on the reserves of that have been in the central bank. Now, when those dollars run out, you have an issue of being able to buy food and goods and stuff coming from abroad. Because it is always based on U.S. dollars. I can't go to the U.S. and say with a Dutch Antillean guilder and say, give me a loaf of bread, because you can buy it.
I had Mr. Brian Mingo, the CEO of the airport here last week, mm-hmm. and I asked him about the U.S. pre-clearance. Mm. And he said that it will cost the airport an additional $80 million in investment, that's initial investment, mm-hmm. and then there are few tens of millions of dollars annually just to keep it operational. What are your thoughts on that?
Well, you know, I will say that Mr. Brian Mingo and I have some serious differences of opinion on the airport and its future. You know, the director, it's unfortunate that you would have an airport that is owned by government. The government of St. Martin, and I'm not sure, but I think at least 70% of the parties that are involved want to see U.S. preclearance. I have not heard of one country in the world, Oral, that has been offered U.S. preclearance and has turned it down, okay? Only St. Martin is telling, or let's put it this way, the airport is telling the government, St. Martin, the shareholder, I don't think U.S. preclearance is good for you. And I think this is a serious situation where we as St. Martin are looking at the airport. One of, first of all, has gotten monies from government in terms of taking care of its salaries, has gotten monies from government from the trust fund, has gotten basically a bank guarantee from the government of St. Maarten. And then basically you tell the government of St. Maarten, I am not going to do none of these things. And I think that is where a situation is comes down, that now you're looking only for yourself and not, you're not looking for the country of St. Maarten. There's a member, I believe, on the board of the airport that told the airport to, I think it was appointed by the Dutch, he's from Aruba. And he's told them, the cost, exactly what you're saying, the cost is too much. And I've stated it publicly, and I say it with you. Ask the member from Aruba that sits on the board of the airport of St. Maarten, so a competitor to St. Maarten sits on the board of St. Maarten, the airport board of St. Maarten, and he tells you, don't go for U.S. pre-clearance. So my question would be, when is Aruba going to close their U.S. pre-clearance? And if they can't say next week or 2 weeks from now, then how can you tell me in St. Maarten what is good for me, and you are not doing it? Because you are in a competitive advantage over that of St. Maarten, and you are telling St. Maarten. And first of all, Oral, there are many advantages to U.S. pre-clearance. One, and you're a traveler, and I think many of the people of St. Maarten are travelers. We would now be considered a domestic flight. So once you clear customs and immigration here in St. Maarten, you know, you land in the U.S., you go straight through, you pick up your luggage and you're in your cab or your whatever. It means now, instead of, you know what happens in St. Maarten now, we tend to have a operating window between 12 and 3 o'clock in the day. It means now that once you pass U.S. pre-clearance, we can have flights later, and we could even have flights earlier, because it opens up different avenues in the U.S., because now I don't have to go to an international gate, I can go to a domestic gate. And these are things that, you know, it's very unfortunate, and I've stated it to the airport, and I think many members of parliament have stated it. You are telling us why we shouldn't, and you're not telling us how we should. And I'm saying, if you tell the airlines, listen, with a certain cost, I'm able to save you on the cost of doing an international gate in the U.S. I don't no longer have to send you through the U.S. Customs, U.S. Immigration. Would you be willing to pay an extra $20 per passenger there? And I'm very sure, and I'm 99% sure, that it would be handled. So the problem is, we have an airport that is dictating to the shareholder what it wants to see for the country, which I think is ludicrous. The big issue that we have with cruise tourism now, and I'm never a person of doom and gloom, but you have to give the facts. COVID is a disease or virus or whatever we want to call it, that is susceptible to the elderly. Guess who now is the ones that can really afford the cruise? People that usually in their retirement or have some money, and that's the majority of the cruisers that we have. So they are also the ones that are more susceptible to the virus itself. So the problem that the cruise lines have is their main market is also driven towards COVID itself. So how are you going to get around that? Because again, in the cruise industry, there is no way that you can do social distancing. Those ships, Oral, have been designed with buffet tables galore, people standing in line, thousands of people moving on a ship, thousands of staff moving on a ship. So it's very hard to be able to, you know, constantly be cleaning and whatever else from. Then also, you have the situation that they're coming off on different islands. So you never know that, okay, they get on the cruise and they're COVID-free, let's call it that.